In lesson 3.4, you can put a small piece of clay on one end of a balance and a tea light candle on the other. Just be sure that the clay weighs less than the candle. So when kids see that the candle weighs more than the clay, take both and put them in some water, and kids will see that the candle floats and the clay sinks. So the question is, why did the heavier one, the candle, float, and the lighter one, the clay, sink? So we want kids to begin to apply the idea of density to the context of sinking and floating. Eventually, we want students to see that the candle floated because it's less dense than water, and the clay sinks because it's more dense than water. And we also want them to see that the reason why the candle is less dense and the clay is more dense has to do with the molecules that they're made of compared to water molecules. So one way to have students compare the density of water to the density of wax is to compare the weight of equal volumes. So if you put a tea light candle in its little aluminum container on one side of the balance, take the candle out and just have the container on the other side, so you'll have equal volumes. You can fill this side, this container, with water. So you're comparing a volume of water to an equal volume of wax. And you'll see that the water weighs more than an equal volume of wax. Therefore, water must be more dense, because that's the definition of density, is mass per unit volume. If you compare the same volume, the one that's more massive must be more dense. So the question then is, why is water more dense than wax? Well, one way to answer it is to look at the molecules that wax and water are made from. Wax is made of carbon and hydrogen. Those are pretty light. Hydrogen is the lightest of all atoms, and carbon is pretty light too. And water is made of, also made of hydrogen, but oxygen instead of carbon. Oxygen is a little smaller and a little heavier than carbon. So based on the atoms that make up water compared to the atoms that make up wax, water should be more dense. Well, another big reason is that water molecules are packed more closely than the molecules that make up the wax. So water, it makes sense that water is more dense. Then we have students put clay in one of the tea light candle containers and water in the other. And it's obvious that the clay is much heavier than an equal volume of water. And for the exact same reason as we talked about before, here the clay is made from pretty heavy atoms, aluminum, silicon, packed very closely together. It makes sense the clay would be more dense than water. So when you compare equal volumes, the clay side of the balance goes down. Now, clay is more dense than water, but lots of teachers do an activity where they make a clay boat. So why is it that if you take one ball of clay and flatten it out into a pancake and then build it up like into a bowl kind of shape, you can make it float? Well, the reason for that is that this shape of clay actually displaces a lot more water than this shape of clay. If you put this in water, it'll displace about 50% more than the same amount of clay in a ball shape. So when you get to a volume that's big enough and it displaces enough water, it'll float. In fact, the key is to get the volume large enough so it displaces a mass of water that's equal to the mass of the object, then it'll float. There's another way to analyze this whole idea of sink and float in a more physics kind of way through referring to the buoyant force. Now, just really quickly, we have a teacher background information at this link right here with some information about the buoyant force, that there's on any submerged object, the force below it is greater than the force above it. So there's a net upward force called the buoyant force on any object. And you can read this to see what that has to do with sinking and floating. If you're in an NGSS state, the performance expectation MSPS1-1 says develop models to describe the atomic composition of simple molecules and extended structures. So they want students to develop models to describe atoms and molecules so they understand their structures. But kids have seen water and wax and clay, and they see those atoms and they have a particular composition as molecules, all within the context of density. The foundation boxes for this performance expectation, you can see that students are supposed to develop a model to describe phenomena, and that they plan and carry out investigations. That's all done in lesson 3.4. Substances are made from different types of atoms. We've looked at that with water and clay and wax. And they understand that each pure substance has a characteristic physical and chemical property, in this case, physical property of density, based on the size, mass, and arrangement of the atoms. And if we look at cross-cutting concepts, scale, proportion, and quantity, students use a microscopic or submicroscopic scale of atoms and molecules to understand the macroscopic observation and characteristic of density. So in that case, they're using this idea of scale, proportion, and quantity. So thanks for watching, and good luck with the lesson.